Hey, good morning, everybody. Welcome to New Bethel Baptist Church. I am Dexter Nuttall, pastor here at New Bethel in Washington, D.C. So excited that you have chosen to worship with us on this gorgeous Sunday morning. I'm here in our sanctuary, and while we are shut in and not gathering in person, we are gathered in the virtual sanctuary. And you know what? I've learned that this virtual sanctuary has some real power. We are excited that we are rooted in Christ and growing in community, and you are part of that community where you can belong, and we all can believe, and we all can become. There are a few things that I want to share with you. If you are worshiping with us for the first time, I want to invite you to text the word guest to 202-798-8927. That can include you in our community that receives an electronic circular about everything taking place in the life of our church. Also want to invite you to visit our website at newbetheldc.org. A couple of special announcements that are taking place. Want you to know that if you are in the class of 2020, our graduating class of 2020, high school, college, vocational school, whatever the case may be, we want to celebrate you. So we need for you to share your information with us in order that we can share a special gift with you, and we can have a special way of recognizing your graduation in the 2020. We know that graduations aren't happening in the way that they traditionally do, but you know what? We want to celebrate you because you are worth celebrating. So share your information with us at our website so that we can get in touch with you. Want you to know that on June the 12th, we're having a worship arts night. We are looking for folks who are gifted and blessed in all of the arts. Maybe you sing, maybe you dance, maybe you are an instrumentalist, maybe you are a spoken word artist, whatever the case may be. If you can get in touch with us on June the 12th, we are going to highlight the arts, because God moves and works through the arts. And so we're looking for performers and dancers and singers and musicians. Get in touch with us, info@newbetheldc.org. And then I'm really excited that on May the 25th, we're going to host a town hall gathering. We've learned throughout this shut-in season because of the coronavirus that there are folks that we are connecting with not only across this country but across the world. And we are creating a framework that will allow for connection and community in and with New Bethel across the world. So if you're interested in that, and you are curious to find out about how it is that you might help us coordinate activity in your area, we want for you to get in touch with us. That's going to take place on May the 25th at 7:30 p.m. via Zoom. If you would text guest and get connected with us at that number I mentioned earlier, 202-798-8927, you'll be invited and receive all the information that you need to have in order to join with us and be part of the New Bethel community. Hey, I'm excited for worship today. Our praise and worship team is ready to lead us in. There's a word today that is going to bless your life, I believe. And I want to challenge you, get with somebody today, even if you're only with them on the phone. Because today, our message has to do with community and working together and being the body of Christ. And we're going to learn and hear about how Reuben is used in order that God might do great things in Joseph's life and in the kingdom of God. You ready? Come on, let's go to church.
Good morning, I'm Minister Nathaniel Wallace, and before we get into worship this morning, let's start off with a scripture and prayer. I'll be reading from Romans 15:13 of the NIV, and it reads, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and all peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." Let's pray. Father God, thank you for the hope, Father God. Thank you for the joy that you've given us, Father God. Thank you for this opportunity to worship, even in these times, Father God. Thank you for your overflow of miracles and blessings, Father God. Even when we don't see a way out, Father God, but we know that you will provide. Father God, we know that you will take care of us. We know that you are a comforter. We know that you are the one that can overflow us with everything that we need, Father God. Let your spirit flow through us. Let your joy flow through us. Let your hope flow through us. Let your peace flow through us. Overflow, God. Father God, fill us up, Father God, so that all worry that we're going through, Father God, that you'll take care of it all. That you'll take care of all of our situations, all of our sicknesses, all of our issues, Father God. Everything, Father God, that you will provide. Father God, and we thank you on this day, Father God. In your Son, Jesus' name, amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. I was glad when they said unto me, come, let us go into the house of the Lord. I don't know about you, but I came to make a joyful noise unto the Lord and to sing unto him a new song. Join with us as we minister this song. It's done. If you believe it, receive it in Jesus' name.
Sweet.
believe that it's already done. Come on and lift your voice. Hallelujah. Give him glory. Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah. Keep praising, keep praising, keep praising, keep praising, keep praising, keep praising. Keep praising, yes, keep praising. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Right where you are.
Hallelujah.
Right where you are.
Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah. Oh. Yeah. How many of you know we serve a mighty God? God above all gods, above all names. No matter where you are, in your car, in your home, I just want to remind you of one thing.
They bow before you.
Yeah.
Heaven and earth adore you. The earth is filled with your glory. Oh.
Heaven and earth adore you, sir.
Heaven and earth adore you.
The earth
is filled with your glory.
And all you've been through, this pandemic has to teach you something. He's a mighty God. Put those hands together and give God some praise right now. Right now, your body may be in a pandemic. Your body may be quarantined, but God's Spirit is everywhere. God's Spirit is everywhere. It doesn't matter what the situation is. It doesn't matter what it looks like. God is. God is mighty. The mighty God.
God, you are a mighty God. God, you are an awesome God. You are an excellent God. You are a powerful God. You are a sovereign God, and we bless your name today, O Lord. We thank you, O God, for the privilege of worship, and we thank you, O God, for your Spirit that is in this space all around us, wherever it is that we are, you are there, and we give you worship. I ask your forgiveness of my sins in this moment, O God. I ask that you would have mercy against me and hold not the sins of this your servant against these your people. And I pray, oh God, that you would show your might again today. Show your power again today. Speak, oh God, in such a way, God, that our lives are changed, that we are transformed, that we are given clarity, that we are made better. I pray even, oh God, that you would draw someone to yourself today, that someone might be saved. And I give you thanks and praise for it. Already in the marvelous, wonderful, matchless name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. What an awesome God. What a mighty God we serve. And I'm expecting God to speak in a wonderful, mighty, and awesome way today. Come on, let's dive into this word that God has planted in me for the day. It is an extension into this Becoming series that we have been talking about from the life of Joseph in Genesis. And we're in Genesis chapter 37, and we're going to pick up at verse 18. I'm going to read from the New Living Translation today. It's Genesis chapter 37, beginning at verse 18. When Joseph's brothers saw him coming, they recognized him in the distance. As he approached, they made plans to kill him. "Here comes the dreamer," they said. "Come on, let's kill him and throw him into one of these cisterns." I want you to remember that word, cisterns. "We can tell our father a wild animal has eaten him. Then we'll see what comes of his dreams." But when Reuben heard of their scheme, he came to Joseph's rescue. "Let's not kill him," he said. "Why should we shed any blood? Let's just throw him into this empty cistern here in the wilderness. Then he'll die without our laying a hand on him." Reuben was secretly planning to rescue Joseph and return him to his father. So when Joseph arrived, his brothers ripped off the beautiful robe he was wearing. Then they grabbed him and threw him into the cistern. Now the cistern was empty. There was no water in it. Amen. Well, this is the next installment, if you will. I think we're on part four of our Becoming series. If you follow us here at New Bethel and you have connected with our ministry, you know that our theme for the year is belong, believe, become. And so we have preached through each of those elements, elements of community, elements of faith, and now we are talking about becoming. You know, one of the blessings that I've enjoyed during the course of this shut-in season has been worshiping with my family.
When we're on a normal schedule, I don't always get to worship with my family because I'm on the podium and they're in the pew. But during the course of the shut-in season, I've been able to worship with my family. And a couple weeks ago, I was home and we were all together on the couch. We were enjoying a worship experience, and all of a sudden, I felt this hand on the top of my head. It was soothing to me at the time, and I didn't think much of it at first because my family is pretty affectionate, and we always give little love taps and touches as we pass one another in the hallway, in the house. But this time, the hand didn't move. It was my youngest daughter, Jada, and she had placed her hand on my head. And rather than saying anything about it, I just basked in the moment, wanting it to last as long as she would allow it to. Because I was reminded that when my girls were little, I would go into their room while they were sleeping, and I would put my hand on their head, and I would pray. It was my way of blessing my girls, and I would ask God to cover them. I would ask God to watch over them. I would ask God to protect them. I still do it from time to time, even now, just not as often. But when I do, it's always with the same motive in mind. God bless my girls. God watch over them. God protect them. But it's not the same as when they were little, because my girls are a little older now. They make decisions for themselves. They are coming into their own. They are establishing their own lives. So when Jada placed her hand on my head, it was like role reversal. Because for most of their lives, I was the one that was blessing them. But in this moment, she was blessing me. I used to be the one who was looking out for them. But on this occasion, she was looking out for me. And God clearly spoke to me in that moment, and he said, you never know how God is going to move and where your blessing is going to come from. Because this I assure you, as you are on your road to becoming, as you are on this journey from season to season and place to place, I promise you that God is going to bless you in a way and through some people that you would least expect it. I don't know who this is for today. I don't know who I'm talking to right now, but I need to tell you this. There will come a time in your life when things begin to click for you. Things begin to happen for you. Opportunities will come your way, and they'll seek you out even before you seek them out. You'll have your choice of where you want to live. You'll have your choice of what you want on your menu to eat. You'll have your choice of who wants to hang out with you. But never forget that nobody gets anywhere without some help. And this is why this episode in Joseph's life is so important to us as we talk about becoming. This is why this word is for somebody who's in a bedroom, in a dining room, somebody in a home listening right now. Joseph's brothers have decided that they are going to kill him. The original plan was not simply to put Joseph in a pit. The original plan was for the pit to be a grave. And the miracle of God dictated that the pit became Joseph's platform to put him in Egypt, where he ultimately would be elevated to be second in command. So if you're taking notes, that's the first lesson right there. Just because you have a setback between where you are and where you're going doesn't mean that the setback will be final or fatal. That's a good word for somebody who's concerned about what's taking place right now in the middle of this health crisis. I need you to know Joseph's brothers threw him in a cistern. A cistern. a cistern was full of water and typically used for torture and burial. In other words, if you were in a cistern, there was a good chance that you were going to die. You weren't put in a cistern for it to be a holding place. You were put in a cistern for the cistern to be your grave. But sometimes God uses what's supposed to kill you to position you. Yes, yes, God has strange ways of doing things. And because we don't always trust God, we see God as weird. We see God as doing strange things in ways that we don't understand. And the truth of the matter is, we have problems believing that God knows what he's doing. So we have a way of trying to help God out. We like to help God out with being God. And sometimes you have to remind yourself that God has always been God. And God really doesn't need any help being God. Because God always has a method to his madness. I need for you to know that. Just because you are experiencing a setback, or just because you are in a season when you think that your dream is over, the setback is not intended to be final or be fatal. And the pit is not intended by God to be your grave. The pit is intended, as it was for Joseph, to be the platform for God to move you to the place that God has intended to fulfill the dream. So why would God allow you to lose something so dear in a pandemic? Maybe it was so that you wouldn't put what you lost in God's place. Why would God allow your enemies to get one up on you? Maybe it was because God wanted to show you that he really is able to make your enemies your footstool. Why would God allow the relationship to fall apart? Maybe it was because the relationship was pulling you away from God rather than pushing you closer toward God. Why would God allow a pandemic across the entire world? This ain't just a pandemic in DC. This ain't even just a pandemic on the East Coast or the United States. This has shut everything down across the world. Why would God allow such chaos in the form of a pandemic across the world? Well, maybe it's because there's somebody on the other side of the world that needs to see a broadcast just like this one to hear that there is a God in heaven who saves. To hear that there is a God in heaven who loves you above and beyond whatever the pit is that you think that you are in. So the thing that you thought would kill you is actually the thing that God is using to protect you. Consider the fact that you thought it was to take you out and God put it there to cover you. I am convinced that on the other side of this crisis, people are going to be better and closer to God than they were before, because we'll come to understand that there are some things that nobody can fix but God. There are some illnesses that nobody can heal but God. There are some dilemmas that nobody can answer but God. There are some demons, yes, some demons, that nobody can fight but God. And so on the other side of the crisis, you're going to learn how to pray. You're going to know how to worship. You're going to know how to praise. You're going to understand what it means to lift your hands in worship. You're going to learn how to worship like you've never worshiped before, because you thought that you'd be dead by now. You thought that the pit was going to drown you. You thought that the cistern was going to torture you and to be your burying place. But can I tell you, like the old church folk used to say, I thank God that the pit is not my cooling board. and that the sheets are not my winding sheets. You shall live and not die. God said, not so. You shall not die. The pit shall not take you out. The pit was not to kill you. It was to prepare you. It was to prepare you. And watch this. God uses one of Joseph's brothers to save the day. Look at this. Look at this. It says that Joseph's brothers see him coming. And when they see him coming, they recognize him in the distance. And as he approaches, they begin making plans. They say, look at the dreamer. Tim, you'll understand this. They start joning. In D.C., we would call this joning. Let me explain what joning is, because I know there's some folk that are not from D.C. that's in the sanctuary with us right now. Joning is when you crack jokes on somebody at their expense. And so you joan on them. You talk about their mother. You talk about where they live. You talk about where they drive. You do things to pull them down. Now here's the thing about Jonah. For real, there's more going on in the Joning match than you think. Because it's not just about making the crowd laugh. It's really about the person who's doing the Joning lifting themselves up. And so what's going on when we used to joan as kids was, you're really trying to make yourself feel better at the expense of somebody else. And this is what I see that's taking place right here in the story. His brothers are on the wall, and they see Joseph coming with his coat on. And they begin to joan on Joseph. And I don't believe that it's really about Joseph. I believe it's really about themselves. Because, you know, people will try to pull you down to lift themselves up. When other folk don't have a dream, they'll try to take your dream, because misery really does love company. But here's what the Bible says. The Bible says that Reuben was secretly planning to save Joseph. Here's the question that I have. As the brothers are on the wall and they see Joseph approaching, what would make Reuben decide that he was going to come to the rescue? Here's what I believe. I believe that it may have been because he came to realize that you don't have to pull somebody else down in order to lift yourself up. This is better. Somebody needs to just tap the screen a couple times right there. The point I'm trying to make to you is that everybody needs a Reuben. Everybody needs somebody who's going to help them get to where God wants them to go. Nobody gets to where they're going without some help. And so when it comes to relationships, let me just issue this word of caution. Be careful. Because if you read to the end of the story, you will find that Reuben actually needs Joseph more than Joseph needs Reuben. Be careful about burning bridges. Be careful about how you treat people, because you never know when you might be entertaining angels unaware. Sometimes it's the people that you least expect that will help you the most. So don't ever discount the power of God to use conviction. Conviction. You think it's a legal word, but I want to suggest to you that it's a spiritual word. Conviction is when the Spirit of God falls down on you when You were supposed to do something that God instructed you to do. The Spirit of God is when the power of God falls down on somebody else who would have tried to take you out, but God forces them to open a door on your behalf. And so can I just be honest and let you know what I've discovered in my life? I had some Reubens. Where are the Reubens in the house? I had some Reubens that prayed for me when I didn't pray for myself. I had some Reubens that counseled me when I was out there acting a fool. I had some Reubens that looked out for me when I wasn't looking out for myself. Sometimes there are folk that God is in the middle of and God is using to be a blessing to your life. Everybody needs a Reuben. Everybody needs somebody to lift them up every now and then. Everybody needs somebody to encourage them every now and then. And I can't speak for you, but I thank God for all the Reubens in my life, because I had a preacher that prayed for me. I had a deacon that prayed for me. I had a grandmother that prayed for me. I love that song that says, I'm so glad they prayed. I'm so glad they prayed for me. I'm so glad they prayed for me. Sometimes you need a Reuben. And not only that, but here's the last thing. Everybody needs some Reubens. And sometimes God calls you to be somebody else's Reuben. Uh-huh, yeah. This is for somebody who feels like you're the only one that God has to tend to. This is for somebody who thinks that God only has your prayers to entertain. Sometimes what it is that you are dealing with is for the sake and the benefit and the blessing of somebody else. Woo, that's good preaching. That's good preaching. Say that again, Pastor D. I think I will. Sometimes God is using you to be a blessing to somebody else. Sometimes you need a Reuben, but sometimes the Reuben is you. And so I need you to understand something. Reuben is used by God in a great way. First of all he does is plant a little seed. He just plants a little seed. He just puts it out into the environment. And sometimes, you know, when you speak the right words out into the environment, things start to change. Sometimes it's just about you speaking a word and putting it out into the atmosphere, and God will take it and work a transformation all around you. Reuben just plants the seed. And watch this. If Reuben does not plant the seed, then Joseph does not make it to Egypt. If Joseph does not make it to Egypt, he does not end up being bought by Potiphar. If Joseph is not bought by Potiphar, he never gets wrongly accused of raping Potiphar's wife. If he never gets accused of raping Potiphar's wife, he never finds himself in jail with a baker and a cupbearer. If he never ends up in jail with a baker and a cupbearer, he never gets to show his gifts. Yeah, and if he never shows his gifts, he never gets elevated to second in command. What are you saying, Pass? All I'm telling you is that all things work together for the good of them who love God and trust God and worship God and praise God and exalt God when they're in the pit and even when they're in the palace. All things, even a pandemic, to work together for the good of those, so that you can praise God in season and you can praise Him out of season. They say ain't but two times to praise God: when you're in season and when you're out of season. And might I add, when things are good and when things are bad, when you're sick and when you're well, when you're prospering and when you're needing. Listen. I need for you to understand and know that sometimes you are the one that God wants to use Yes, you are the Reuben. Somebody type in the box, I am Reuben. Type it in the box, I am Reuben. Because here's the deal. Somebody's salvation is waiting on you to move. Yeah, somebody's deliverance is waiting for you to move. Somebody that you didn't even know knew your name is watching you. And they want to see if you're faithful enough to trust this God in pandemic seasons. Somebody wants to know if you're trusting God with bad news swirling all around you. The Bible says that we overcome by the power of our testimonies. And because God has done it for you, you can tell somebody else, look at what, oh God, he's done for me. What he's done for others, he's able to do for you. He wants to use you. He wants to make you Reuben. And isn't it wonderful to know that even when Reuben doesn't show up, he still sends a Savior. Here's the wonderful thing about this story. The brothers who are on the wall, joning on Joseph, hating on Joseph, consumed with God's destiny for Joseph, God has his own destiny for them. This is the cadre of brothers that become the tribes of Israel. This is the nation that produces our Savior. And here they are so consumed with Joseph that they can't even wrestle and embrace the destiny that God has for them. All I'm trying to get you to see is that we need each other. We need each other. God speaks to us through each other. We need each other to extend love to one another, to be accountable for one another, to extend joy to one another, to speak peace to one another, to speak into one another's lives. Who are you speaking life into? Who needs to hear from you? Who needs to understand and hear your testimony about how God is able to deliver from a cistern? About how God is able to bring life into lifeless predicaments and situations? Who are you supposed to be Reuben for? I praise God that God is able to work all things together for our good. I praise God that God is able to work all things out in due season. If we faint not. But here's the condition. Here's the condition. As we move on this journey, it was never about the pit or the palace to begin with. It's always been about relationship with him. There's a covenant relationship that God desires that we live into. He's made the covenant promise to you. Have you embraced the covenant? Have you embraced the promise? Are you living proof and testimony to what it is that God can do? Giving acknowledgement to the fact that we have a Savior who can deliver, that we have a Savior who can redeem you from the pit? If you don't have that testimony today, you can have it. You can have it right now. You can embrace it right now. All of us are in the process of becoming. All of us are on this journey, and we're on it together. We live it out in community, in relationship with one another. But we got to have our own personal, individual relationships with Christ. You got to know him for yourself. I'm so glad somebody prayed for me. I'm so glad somebody called my name. But there comes a time in your life when you need to be able to go for yourself, when you need to be able to do it for yourself. And if you don't have that relationship with him, can I encourage you to get it right with him today? Because the Bible says that it's very easy. He says, anybody who knocks, he'll open the door for you. Anybody who seeks, he is waiting and wanting to be found. Anybody who confesses sin and asks for salvation, he will come in. And there is no condemnation for any of us that are in Christ Jesus. That's the good news. That makes me shout every time I hear it. There's no condemnation. Doesn't matter what you've done to anybody else up to this point. Doesn't matter where you've been up to this point. Doesn't matter what your story is up to this point. All that matters is that you would realize and recognize him as Lord and Savior of your life. And you can do that by a prayer. So here's what I want to do. If you're interested and willing to pray that prayer today, if you would just dial the number that's on your screen, if you would text the word connect to 202-798-8927, text the word connect to that number. That will extend a text into our ministry right now, into our ministers. We have ministers that are waiting to receive that communication for you. And once we receive it, we're going to reach out to you. We're going to pray with you. We're going to answer the questions that you might have about how it is that Jesus Christ redeems us by death on a cross, by shedding his blood in order that our sins might be forgiven. We're going to explain to you what it means that he was wounded for our transgressions, that he was bruised for our iniquities, because we want you to become. And we want you to belong to this fellowship, to this community of believers. We want you to be connected so that you can have a Reuben and so that you can be a Reuben. We want you to know that the pit was not meant to take you out. It was actually meant to lift you up. Won't you receive that invitation today? Just text that word connect to that number, 202-798-8927. And I'm looking forward with great anticipation to how it is that God lifts us up and brings us out together, stronger than ever before, more faithful than ever before, more blessed than ever before. God bless you. So glad that you worship with us today. May the grace and the peace and the love and the favor of God overwhelm you today, tomorrow, and all week long. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. We'll see you next time.